Infinite toilet glitch.
Hey everybody, welcome to Three Guys in a Pie Podcast. I'm your host Jonathan, here with my co-host Gary.
Hello!
Our guest once again, Aaron.
I can't believe it's been a week already.
And back again for a second episode, Lou.
Yep, the fans asked for it, and here I am.
So Gary, what
we don't deserve, but we have.
So why don't you fill us in on what we're going to be talking about today, Gary?
We're going to be talking about video games and why you, for some reason, hate my favorite, Darkest Dungeon.
I never said I hated Darkest Dungeon.
No, I'm pretty sure the way that you came to me when I floated the idea of video games was, I'm probably never going to play Darkest Dungeon ever again.
Correct. Yeah, I'm probably never going to play it again.
And the way that you had said it made it sound like you were just like, this game sucks.
No, what I said was, I've come to the realization about the game that I have come to with many games before it, and because I've come to that realization, I can never play it again.
Okay, so what's your realization about this game?
It's just too grindy. It boils down to a grind for me.
And you don't like grinding games.
No, I hate grinding games.
Really?
I played RuneScape all the time as a kid, and Aaron and I got back into it more recently, and like as soon as it clicked that I wasn't playing it for the gameplay, I was just like grinding levels and like trying to get ahead. I'm like, wait a second, this isn't fun. And like I got to that point with Darkest Dungeon too, where I'm just like, I'm just grinding. Like I don't like the gameplay. It's just repetitive, and like I would like Darkest Dungeon a lot more if it was like a resource management game where I didn't have to like go through the slog of the actually going through the levels. I could just like put a party together, send them, and like manage resources and be doing it that way. I don't like it. Just feels very, it just feels like a slog to have to go through the combat every time, because it's all the same. Like it's never any different. Like I just feel like I'm going through the same thing over and over and over again. I don't like that part of the game.
Well, have you ever played XCOM?
No, I haven't.
Okay. What level difficulty did you play Darkest Dungeon on?
I don't remember. Whatever the default was, probably.
Because, like, so I played Darkest Dungeon, and one of my favorite games ever is XCOM, Enemy Unknown, and its subsequent games. But part of what makes those games really good, because they are grindy, is the mechanics really play into, like, the theme of, in my opinion, of Darkest Dungeon, where you're sending your characters out over and over again, and the idea being it may get a little grindy, but there's also like the risk that your entire party is like structured, like your entire gameplay is structured around your strongest party members. And if something slips up on a routine mission that you're sending them out on and one of them dies, you very quickly could lose, depending on the difficulty you play. Like if you play on the easiest difficulty, probably not. But like on the hardest difficulty where like I think you can only have like 3 or 4 party members die or something throughout the entire time you play.
Like, oh, wait, that's a thing?
Yes.
I didn't realize that.
So you're it does get grindy, but like it's kind of nerve-wracking because if just something small goes wrong.
So that would put a more interesting spin on it, because that's less just throwing people at it, because that's what it kind of felt like to me. Is like I'm constantly like, okay, boom, 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 improve it. I can get better people. Boom, throw them at, throw them, improve it. And like the combat is just so slow and boring for me. Like it's not engaging. It's just the same. Like when you put a party together, it's doing the same thing. I wish I could just automate that.
That's why you got to play Quad Leper. A one way that you might be able to make it less grindy if you ever wanted to go back to it is by just taking the risk of sending low level people into like super high level dungeons, because the risk is that they're not as well equipped to deal with those dungeons, but the reward is they get ridiculously like leveled up and all the good shit happens quicker. So you're running the risk that you're just gonna party wipe every time, but if you somehow come back from it,
yeah, that's just one of those things where it's just like, it's just speeding up the grind.
Right.
Which is, I don't know, I just, the gameplay itself wasn't engaging to me.
There is a neat story with Darkest Dungeon. If you really get into it, like, and you collect, like, you go for collecting all the journal pieces that kind of tell the overarching story of what happened to the hamlet and to your ancestor.
I still have not beaten the Darkest Dungeon, so no spoilers.
I have beaten the first level of the Darkest Dungeon.
Oh, okay, yeah, I've gotten that far once, years ago.
Yeah, I finally did it after, like, 200 weeks in the hamlet. I'm so nervous, because, like, I went in there one time with, like, a full party, and I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna kick whatever the fuck's in here's ass. And then, like, the very first fight, it was just like, oh, you know, crit, 87 damage. I was like, huh. And I'm like, never again. Never again.
I don't know. Darkest Dungeon is a game where I have to kind of take it, like, one play session at a time, play it for 2 or 3 hours, stop playing for a month, come back, play, you know. Because, it gets kind of repetitive and grindy. I mean, but you can break it up, and it's not... Like, if you play differently with different parties and stuff, like, it is different. Like,
yeah, but, like, for me, like, the combat system just always boils down to the same thing to me.
If you don't like the combat in Darkest Dungeon, you're just never going to like the game. Because that's the combat and the exploration are, like, 75% of the game, and everything else is...
I wish they had an auto-combat option that you could just check the box, and you'd send the people in, and it would just go through it on its own.
There might be a mod for that, honestly. Because you play it on PC, just have
the
results.
Yeah, and just have the results be whatever they were.
Yeah, so you actually might be able to find a mod for that, and you might enjoy the game a lot more. Yeah. The other thing I will say, if you play Darkest Dungeon on PC, just start modding it. It makes the game better, but for the right reasons. Because most of the mods that I've downloaded are other classes. Like the Librarian class, the Snake Charmer class, the Thrall, or whatever, the Pugilist, or Pug, however the fuck you say that word. He's basically a gladiator that punches things and gets real mad.
Yeah, like my thing with Darkest Dungeon, it just feels like a free-to-play game that I had to pay for.
I mean, I guess.
And, like, I can't spend money to speed up the process.
Yeah, because it's supposed to be difficult. It's supposed to...
But, like, it's not hard at all. Like, I could see what you were saying. Like, if you had limited deaths, it wouldn't necessarily make it harder. It would just make it more stressful, which...
You want us to reach out to Red Hook and make them turn it into a gotcha. I got it.
I am super excited because we're finally getting some info on Darkest Dungeon 2 trickling out very slowly. They announced that it was going to be a thing, like, 2 years ago with, like, a teaser trailer that was 10 seconds long. And we were like, oh, and then radio silence.
Yeah, I think COVID probably had something to do with it, but...
Yeah, well, COVID delayed a lot of stuff.
Well, it was also... Darkest Dungeon itself was in early access for a very long time. And then the DLCs came out pretty quick, so it makes me wonder if they were trying to get all the DLCs to, like, fit into the game on release, and they eventually just said, no, let's push this out. Because this is a whole game, and then the DLCs will just supplement it. Which it honestly does. Like, The Color of Madness and The Crimson Court are both great, great DLCs for the game, but, like, you don't need it to just play.
Mm-hmm.
Except The Crimson Court gives my absolute favorite class in the game, which is the Flagellant. Fucking Flagellant best boy. So good. So good.
Yeah, this is where I was kicking myself for not... buying Slay the Spire instead of Darkest Dungeon.
Well, Slay the Spire goes on sale quite frequently. You can normally pick it up for like $10 on sale.
Have you never played it?
No. But I know it's like a deck building game, essentially.
I think of it as the world's best toilet game.
You're like, not what? Wrong.
Like,
I play it so much on the shitter because it's on my phone now.
One of the mechanics of Darkest Dungeon, not Darkest Dungeon, of Slay the Spire, is as you... start beating runs as a roguelike, it will ramp the difficulty up. And once you get really, like, far into it, like, I got Ascension, it's like an Ascension level, we call it.
Mm-hmm.
I got Ascension 20 on a bunch of stuff on my PC, and I just got it on my phone a little while ago. So now I have I only have like the first classes ascension level 20, which is as high as it'll go. And the rest of them, I go in order with the four classes they have, trying to get them to ascension level 20.
I think you're making Carrie and Aaron feel bad.
Yeah, dude, I've been fucking grinding so goddamn hard. I finally reached ascension 7 on silent on my phone yesterday.
I think I'm on 18 for silent. I'm not sure.
I've just been trying for some of the like really annoying achievements before I try the higher ascensions.
Yeah.
Like the ones where it's like you can only use common cards or you can only have one relic or something. And I'm like, those are hard.
Oh, yeah. Some of those are crazy. I haven't really gone into the achievements much. But the cool thing about it is like the difficulty ramps up so much that you're usually gated by like the very beginning of the game. So about one toilet session a game.
Yeah.
Depending on your health. And your diet.
It takes me forever to play the game. I am so much slower than you. Like, it takes me like an hour to do a full run.
I can do a full run in about half an hour. I'm not going to succeed.
How long are you guys on the toilet?
No, see, when I poop, I usually get through one act.
Yeah.
And then I'll keep, and then I'll be like, all right, I beat the act one boss. It's time to go to work now.
Exactly. Like, if I'm at home, maybe a couple of minutes. In the bathroom. If I'm at work, as long as I can get away with it.
Occupied!
Yeah, but like similar to how Darkest Dungeon has these, like it's like a grind and it's got these mechanics that can surprise you and have a character die, which ruins your run. Slay the Spire also like has mechanics that like lead into the overall theme of the story. It's hard to bring you into it without ruining the story, but
I didn't even know there was a story in Slay the Spire.
I didn't either until I heard Aaron talking about it.
It's
I just played it as a deck builder.
I wouldn't say it's like a there's not like any written story, I would say, really. It's just kind of like you can interpret what's happening by essentially end credit scenes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it
Gary's like skip, I gotta poop still.
Yeah, but depending on like if you look at those end credit scenes and like the mechanics kind of make sense as a lot of roguelikes will kind of do that too, where they'll fashion a story around you playing the game over and over again. Mm-hmm. Enter the Gungeon did it really well.
Binding of Isaac
did it really well. I can't think of any roguelike lights
at the Risk of Rain do anything like that?
I don't think so.
What is Risk of Rain about?
It's just like, I imagine it's like Slay the Spire, but instead of putting a deck together, you're putting a character together with weapons and stuff.
Mm. Yeah, that's actually a decent way to put it. So yeah. You're a character class with a set number of abilities that do, basically each ability has at least two versions. So you can like kind of customize your class a little bit, but then really you're just going around killing stuff. And then you find these chests and you pay money to unlock the chest and you get like a relic or an item. Relic from Slay the Spire, basically. And it's like that, except they stack. So you can have like 10 of the same relic.
Yeah.
I know what game you might like because it's kind of morphing Darkest Dungeon with Slay the Spire. It's called Deep Sky Derelicts.
Play that a little bit.
Oh, isn't it fucking frustrating?
Isn't that the, like, text-based thing far where you're like a little drone going through like abandoned spaceships and stuff?
Kind of similar, but not. So you have three members of your party, which you choose when you start the game. And normally there's a couple of different, like, you know, there's obviously the tanks, there's the healers, there's like the support classes, and there's the DPS. And, you know, there's a lot of overlap in between them.
Double penetration specialists.
Yeah. and
fuck you.
So your whole goal is to go to these like shipwrecks in space and kind of like gather gear, figure out what happened, why did they crash, you know, make some money and all this. But obviously you're going to find other scavenging crews, monsters, you know, rogue robots, you know, just trying to do their thing.
Sounds like No Man's Sky, but you have a...
Well, and the way it works is your equipment, what you have equipped, gives you your deck for when you fight.
Oh, okay.
So you can supplement your deck with different pieces of equipment, different pieces of equipment to put onto your equipment. The different weapons, equipment upgrades, and like the supplements to your equipment build your deck which help you in your combat scenarios. And it's like a dungeon crawler where you'll walk around this dungeon and you either find like a place to, you know, get loot. You might find someone who's selling shit and rent like random things. But you also have to worry about like your energy cores. You can only explore a ship based off of how much energy you have to run your suits and whatnot. And when you start running out of energy, you slowly start to die. So there's three different ways that you can go through like a shipwreck. One is hasty, which every like you run through it fast, so you use less energy. But every like random fight that happens, you're ambushed. Then there's normal, where, you know, nothing really happens. You go through energy as normal. And then there's stealthy, which you go through energy at like double the rate, but whatever you find, you ambush them. So it's got some resource management. It's got management for your team based off of like their equipment. And it's still like a deck builder because you want your deck to be balanced around like, okay, well, this guy's DPS, he wants more attacks than he wants defense. If this guy's a support, he might want more support cards than attack or defend. And if this guy's a tank, he might want to be able to buff his survivability up. And there's a lot of like multi-classing, like soft multi-classing you can do. The only qualm I have with the game is when you first start, there's no fucking direction. They basically just put you in there and say, figure it out.
That's why I didn't get very far, because I got it because it looked like Darkest Dungeon, and I love games that are heavy on resource management, but also have like, where like, I guess combat is like your micromanagement, and then the overarching goal is to manage a base or a crew to achieve an end goal, which is why I love XCOM, which I will probably plug before the end of this podcast. But yeah, I started Deep Sky Derelict and I was like, I don't know what's going on. So I played for like 2 hours and I kind of put it aside. But I'll probably revisit it now that because it sounds a lot more interesting after you described it.
Well, I think, and we're talking about like difficult games here mostly for hard. This. They definitely fall on a spectrum where one end of the spectrum is random chance and the other is just pure skill. And, like, that, I think my problem with, like, Darkest Dungeon, it sounds like it would be that game, is that falls much more on the random chance spectrum than it does on the, like, Dark Souls end of the spectrum.
So, so in the beginning, when you start with nothing, when you get hit, it really does feel like, well, that hit was bullshit, because it dealt 40 damage. When in reality, it kind of makes sense where, when you're first starting off and you have this much, you can't Dark Souls it where like you're trying to blitz through a fight. You have to be aware that, okay, I'm not going to one-shot these things yet. So I have to keep in mind that, yeah, I would love to attack right now, but my shields are getting low. So I should probably play my, you know, shield recharge, right? So when I first got the game and I first played it, I was like, yeah, this is utter bullshit. Things are killing me way too quickly. And I can't punch my way through this. Because that's my preferred method of playing video games, is punching my way through shit. And then I left it go. And I went and I played a fuck ton of Darkest Dungeon. And I came back to it because I started getting sick of Darkest Dungeon. And I'm like, well, this is kind of like Darkest Dungeon. But it's also kind of like Slay of the Spire, and I'd been playing that too. I'll give it another chance. And after finding some obscure YouTube guide for Deep Sky Derelicts, because there's fucking nothing on the internet for it. There's not even a wiki. That's what pissed me off, is there was no wiki to tell me about, like, the different characters and shit. So you just had to guess. And I watched that video, and it was only, like, 15 minutes. But after watching that, I'm like, oh, things make a lot more sense now. And then I got back into it, and it's like, yeah, you can't blitz your way through it like you might do in Dark Souls, where it's like, you know, yeah, if I get hit a couple of times, it's not going to be a problem because I'm running to this location.
Like, that's not what even what I'm saying, though. Right. Like, whether or not you're able to succeed at Dark Souls is based solely on whether skill. Or not you're able to do the mechanical things you need to do. Right. Whereas, like, in Darkest Dungeon, that 20% mischance, you could stack those 10 times in a row. And, like, that guy, like, I
get
what you're having, like, the amount of randomization is what annoys me.
I get why that's frustrating, but I have a completely different philosophy from you when playing a game. Like, I played all the Souls games. I've beaten most of them, and I really enjoy them. I'm not great at them, but, like, for me, when I'm playing a skill-based game, like shooters are a good example of this. Like I just played Resident Evil 8 and just I finally finished it. When I started, because I had to play on hardcore difficulty because everything underneath that, I'm like, I feel like I'm not achieving anything. And I almost stopped playing the game because without spoiling it, there's like the very first event is so difficult. And the way you get around it is not explained to you. You basically have to go on the internet and find out how it's done to find the trick. And then I finally beat it. And I was like, holy shit, this game is going to be insane because that was like one of the toughest things I've done in any video game. And then the rest of the game was so downhill from there. It was like, it was stupid easy.
That just seems like a poorly ramped
difficulty. I agree, but there's also like, so when playing like in a game like Dark Souls or something like, or like a shooter like that, once you get the hang of things and once you learn how to play and your skill level goes up, it is satisfying to like beat things like that and overcome those challenges. But then there's nothing interesting out of it that really surprises you.
See, that's when I start imposing challenges on myself, like restricting the weapons I'm allowed to use or like constraining my own play styles to make things more difficult.
I mean, that's definitely a cool way about it. But for me, like one of the reasons I like games similar to like Darkest Dungeon and stuff like that is that the game I know going in, like there's certain things that I'm like, okay, I'm going to fail a percentage of times because that's just how the game is set up.
It's like D&D.
Yes. But at the same time, once I get past those points and I'm playing, sure, there might be another event like that that filters me out and there was nothing I can do about it. But there's also really interesting things that come out of that. Like, oh, this weird event caused one of my characters to die, so now I can only slot this other character in who's not that good.
Yeah.
And now I have to play this way, and now I find something really interesting about the way this party works that I probably wouldn't do because if I'm playing it from a skill-based approach, like, this is the best party, I'm bringing this party in every time, and I'm just going to stomp the dungeon. But now I have to do it in a weird way that I wouldn't usually, and I find something interesting and more fun.
Yeah, I think a lot of like how I play video games breaks down to how insanely competitive I am.
Yeah, I feel that.
And like that's why I like games like Dota and Rocket League and Due Process is because like you're constantly, you never hit that curve in a single player game where like everything's easy, especially if you're playing in ranked modes, you're constantly playing against more challenging players and it's...
I'm the same way except...
Things get way more difficult.
Yeah, I'm the same way except I'm not good at competitive games. Same. So I'll play and I'll get really competitive and I'll...
Says the one who's been stomping in Due Process.
Like I played League until I got gold and once I hit gold, I was like, okay...
Oh, must be fucking nice, asshole.
I just hit champ for the first time.
The funny part is I actually... Well, this is kind of the point I'm getting at. I fell out of gold in the same season. I didn't end the season gold.
Same.
Because once I hit gold, I was like, fuck this. I'm done playing. There's like... I'm never going to get past gold. I'm never going to be able to like keep this even if I like it's going to take a level of like... I get like I'm just going to have to keep at this and like keep my skill level up to stay here. And it's just not... worth it. It's not fun anymore.
So, funny story, the highest rank I ever got in League was... So, I don't play ranked much. Even when I was on the esports team, I just didn't. And the highest rank I ever got in League was Silver 2. It wasn't even
League of Legends? I thought you were talking about Rocket League.
No, he was talking about League of Legends.
So, I probably sound like, I was like, I ain't champ.
And the funny part is, it wasn't even me who got there. Some asshole hacked my account and was playing on it. And we're like, wow, why am I at a Silver 2 rank? I haven't been playing ranked. Why do I have so many jungle games as Master Yi? This doesn't make sense.
The other thing about those games, too, is like they're so dependent on your team. When I played with my brother, I thought I was better than him playing with him at the time. And we would never break silver. And then once we like stopped playing together, I think he hit challenger.
Holy fuck.
Yeah, I'm not sure if he went challenger or if he stopped at diamond one, but he's really good at it.
That's still like a huge gap. Holy shit.
Yeah, but that was him playing, I think he plays mid solo.
Yeah, especially in a game like Dota or League of Legends where like
you can solo.
If you're pairing up, if you just switch the lane you're playing, like in Dota, you could carry yourself to way higher MMRs if you're good at mid. Like, you can just carry the same whole game thing to the end.
And that's where my problem was. Back when I used to play a lot of League of Legends, I was a top laner. I've since since transitioned to playing mid lane, although I don't play much League anymore.
You should start playing Dota with
No.
us. We have
no
four people.
I've played right Dota here. Once. I've played Dota once and I didn't like it.
We're one man so short. No.
But yeah, I played top lane during the times where top laners were two people punching each other and they never saw the rest of their team. Because neither of them ever fucking left lane.
Yeah.
It's me and you, and we're either going to win or lose the game, but this is how it goes.
And the thing about that is, like I said, it stops getting fun after a while.
Yeah.
The most fun I had in League was playing before they made crit not affect Gnossus's Q. I played crit Gnossus.
Oh my god.
And I farmed my Q up so high, and I got 100% crit chance, and I remember Gangplank coming into lane, and I Q'd him, and he had literally one health left, and he just immediately ran away. And it was just, like, the most satisfying, thing playing that game.
Yeah.
That and me and my brother used to troll. We would play bottom lane. We would play AP Sion, AP Shaco bottom lane.
You're the worst type of human being.
So we'd stack boxes.
Is this pre or post Sion rework?
Pre-Sion rework.
Oh my god.
So we used to stack boxes in the bush at bottom lane, wait for somebody to come in, and I'd hit them. I played Sion. I'd hit them with a stun on the Q that does a third of their health in damage. And then they just get slammed by five boxes.
Oh my god.
Immediate first blood. And we wouldn't always win, but it was still always satisfying to just... Because, what are you going to do against that? You just lose. They just sat at a tower all game.
And that's back when his stun was a point-and-click ability, too. Yeah.
I remember a game... we play, all the fun stuff, what I'm getting at, is just, not playing the game how you're supposed to.
Yeah,
that's
accurate.
My friend, me and my brother would play with a friend I had that I met on WoW, where he would play Evelynn, and he would stack Sunfire Capes, and my brother would play Shaco, and he would stack Sunfire Capes. So... We would go into a fight.
Hold
with
on. They
three.
Don't play League.
Yeah, we're clueless.
So
I have no idea what you're talking about.
In context, Sunfire Capes deal damage in an AoE around you. Shaco and Evelynn can both go invisible. Now, this was during a time where
so it's like Radiance, but you can have multiple
them.
Of them.
Yes, they used to stack.
Shit.
And this was back before a time where you could see. Nowadays, you can see an invisible creature when it gets close to you. Back then, you couldn't.
Oh, that's weird.
Yes.
Yeah, I remember sitting at mid lane and the guy is typing in all chat what the fuck? Why is my health going down? And my friend is sitting there invisible with this AoE that's just taking damage off of him. And the guy doesn't think anything of it. He wouldn't think that that's what's happening because nobody does that. That's weird. But that's what I was getting at is
It's getting a Radiance on Ricky and people just not realizing what's going on in the game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why...
I used to play Ricky when I played Dota. And I think it was Phantom Lancer, the guy who makes copies of himself.
Yeah.
Honestly, that's the only way I play League of Legends anymore is to play ARAM. Because it's just a fucking... It's constant team fighting. Mm-hmm. And, it's ARAM. So, you don't fucking build whatever. No one's gonna really care unless they're actual assholes. But, yeah, MOBAs...
Playing games for fun?
Yes! normal people! You fuck! But no, definitely give Deep Sky Derelicts another chance.
Yeah.
Especially because they came out with kind of an infinite harvest mode like Darkest Dungeon has.
Huh.
But it's accessible from the main menu. And you don't have to have a running campaign to do it. And I found it's the best to just fuck around and figure out what works on there.
Yeah.
And see how far you can get. And then hop into an actual campaign with more game knowledge. That has been the biggest part of how I learned how to play that game is just by fucking running my parties into the mill and seeing what comes out on what bloody mess comes out on the other side.
See, I think that kind of stuff is really interesting. And definitely the superior way to play a video game rather than look up a wiki and then figure out all this stuff. Imagine going into a game blind with no information about it and just having to figure everything out. Whatever in-game tutorial or walkthrough there might be in-game, and that's it.
Or lack thereof in case of Darkest Dungeon. I was so lost when I started playing that game.
Really?
I'm what the hell am I...
See, Deep Sky Derelicts is even less direct than Darkest Dungeon.
Like, even all, like, the curios you come across. I didn't know that you could, like, slot stuff into them for the longest time.
And
like,
I didn't know that either.
The shovel in the middle, I was like, oh, yeah, I have a shovel in my inventory. I just have to, like, I was taking damage every single time, even though I had shovels in my inventory.
I lost characters to those. I've lost characters to obstacles, I was like, what the fuck? Say.
Yeah.
Aaron. What are some of you, because we've all, me and Lou have been over here sucking Darkest Dungeon's cock for like the last, you know.
And balls.
For the last 30 minutes. So why don't you talk about some of the games you play? Because you play games that are a little bit different than I think what me and Lou play.
I've been playing a lot of like base building games, like Oxygen Not Included.
Oh, that's such a good game.
Prison Architect, I guess technically is one. I don't really like that one quite as much, but and then RimWorld.
RimWorld's great.
Yeah, right.
Have you ever played Dwarf Fortress?
No. I
understand why. It's.
I thought about getting throwback. Into it, but it's yeah. so old and outdated. It physically pains me just to look at screenshots of it.
Oh yeah, it's. I wish I could play Dwarf Fortress more because it is a lot like RimWorld. In fact, it's more.
It sounds superior.
It is. It honestly, so dated. It has so much more depth. It's just the barrier to entry is so strong that even somebody who's like really determined to play it like me still can't get into it as much as I can get into RimWorld because like Dwarf Fortress has no graphics. You like it's literally like symbols on a keyboard, like on your keyboard. Just I think like the at symbol is a cat, so you have to know you have to like you see this like picture of code and you have to translate it into what things are just by like looking at it. Now they've come out with texture packs to make it easier, but
okay, that must be what I'm looking at here.
Yeah. Yeah. One of the nice things I was going to mention is like they are going to bring.
Oh dear God.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it's an old game.
It is, but Steam is going to come out with like a more official, nicer version for UI. But RimWorld's a great game. That's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's just a simple.
It seems like they have actually.
It's not. I don't think it's out yet, unless it was released and I missed it.
So RimWorld is like a top down. Colony simulator where you start out with a set number of colonists. I mean, you can customize your starts and stuff, and then you know you basically have different. You have like season events, and you gotta like grow food and keep people alive. You know, make clothing or steal clothing off travelers that pass through. And there's like a bunch of different guns, and you get like raided by pirates and stuff. And
you might like Banished. It's like a medieval village simulator where you have like a collection of people that are basically dropped off into the wilderness. They have a certain amount of materials. They have a certain number of, like, livestock and seeds. And the entire goal of the game is to just see how long your village can survive. I have not gotten past year 10 because it's fucking difficult. Because you run into a problem. There's three stages of, like, life for your villager. Child, adult, and then elderly. And you run into the situation where all the adults are becoming elderly and then dying while the children are still children, and children can't do jobs in the village. So all the parents die, no one are doing the jobs, you run out of food, and then the kids die too. It's hard, but it's fun. I will say it's fun.
Yeah, but RimWorld has some neat stuff. Like, people get diseases and stuff. You can do surgeries, or you can, like, harvest people's organs. Oh my God. And, like, you can, like, tame animals, and, like, you can get, like, attack warthogs and stuff and just like get it like tame a bunch of wild pigs and then just send them at the enemy when they come raiding in. Oh, God. like there's rhinos and elephants and you know horse different stuff like that and there's
lions mods and tigers and bears and, oh my
there's techs and you know different you know guns and melee weapons and you know a bunch of different little things you can do with that, but it's just a nice like fun little thing. Yeah. And there's enough RNG or you can build it with enough RNG that it's like sometimes you just have a really shit year and you lose half your people and the game is just screwing you over and there's not much you can do, depending on what difficulty you play on and stuff.
Yeah, I mean, the level of risk from those games kind of comes from the fact that you can't directly make anyone do anything, which is pretty interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you can like, I guess you can kind of like kind of assign people different roles, right?
Yeah, you can, so there's different like types of work and you set their priorities basically and then they go and kind of do it. And then you can directly, it's called drafting in RimWorld, like draft them as like a soldier and then you can directly control them, but only for like combat oriented tasks. But for the most part, yeah, you just kind of set the priorities and like maybe like allowed zones and different things and then the colonists kind of do their own thing.
See, that's why I'm surprised you don't like Age of Empires and stuff. I feel like those would be...
I thought he does like Age...
I'm not a huge RTS fan.
The
only RTS game I really play is AI War, which is like a little indie game. But you know, the important thing to me is it's single player and it's pausable. My problem with Age of Empires and stuff like that is I literally just can't control the unit, like do everything simultaneously like people do in these games, and it just takes the fun out of it, because it's like I either have to constantly be pausing or like I just can't focus and do all that stuff.
That was my problem with StarCraft. There was so much stuff going on at once that you have to micromanage and be on top of that, like, I would take, like, a good just minute looking at my shit and going, okay, what do I do now? And by then, I'm dead.
See, you guys you're playing StarCraft wrong. I got to plat in StarCraft Duos by just playing Zerg Rush. All you have to do is get a good 6 or 7 games with people with their pants down, and you solidify your platinum status and never play the game again. Either that or Cannon Rush.
See, my thing was, I never liked... The class that I loved the most was Protoss. And I feel like they're hard to play because I still don't understand them. And I played that a lot.
Yeah,
the problem with RTS games like that is just it's you can play the game well or you can enjoy it. For me, I can't do both. Like one of the reasons I like the Total War games, because I can pause it, slow it down. Like I can move the units, set everything up, and then just kind of watch them fight for 30 seconds at a time and not have to micromanage a million other things simultaneously. Like, you can actually, like, watch the units fight and stuff, and it's fun.
The skill floor for RTS is extremely high if you're going to play, like, a multiplayer version.
If I ever tried to... Like, I thought I was good at Age of Empires, and then I played against someone who was actually good at Age of Empires. I couldn't even develop. It was just like, you're here with an army, and you're in, like, the third age. I'm in the second age, and I can't do anything.
That's actually why I, like, stopped playing after I got as far just Zerg rushing people, because, like, people could harass me to stop... Like, with one or two units, they could stop me from doing anything, because I'm literally just trying to deal with this, and meanwhile, they're, like, developing their own base and, like, two other bases at the same time. And I'm like, this person's fucking insane. How do you do that?
Yeah. And that's, like, another... Like, I either like really high-skill games or games where you can just raffle-stomp everything in a very satisfying way. So, like, in Age of Empires, I like just, like, steamrolling the AI. Or in, like, Titan's Quest, where it's just, like... The game's not hard. It's just incredibly satisfying.
Just
to, like,
hold left mouse, run around, click on monsters till they're dead.
Yeah. Like, Titan's Quest is probably still one of my favorite games.
Yeah, I definitely like games where I don't like games where I have to think way too hard. Like League, like you can be really mechanical in League if you want to be. I'm not one of those people. I can play each character with relative amount of success, but I excel on the brain dead ones because it's just like, oh, I'm full AP Malphite. Oh, look, you're gone.
See, yeah, like in games like that, like I always, I don't know if it's something I do subconsciously or actively, but like I single out the most difficult to play heroes.
It's because you're competitive.
Pick them.
Yeah, it's because you're competitive, and like that's when you learn a character that has a very high
skill cap,
and you become quite good with it. That's just a way of demoralizing the opponent, really. Because, like, I would say probably back when you played the game, the most mechanically intense champion was probably Riven.
I guess. I always thought Riven was bullshit, though.
She is. You're absolutely correct. She should not gain a shield based on attack damage. That just shouldn't be a thing, but she gets it. And she shouldn't get 3 different hops and a stun and a knock-up. My favorite thing was, do you remember old school Yorick?
Yeah. My brother used to play that a lot.
That used to be my main.
He used to play AP Yorick and harass somebody literally to death with the...
Yeah, with the green ghoul.
Yeah.
Yep, because it's scaled. Yeah. My favorite thing was always playing Yorick, which was always looked at as the shittiest character in the game, and just fucking waffle stomp the fucking Rivens to the ground.
Waffle stomp?
Yeah. It's when you take a shit in the shower and then you stomp it down the drain.
Oh my god, I've never heard of that. Because I always say raffle stomp.
Yeah, I mean...
Like R-O-F-L?
See, I never understood that word.
Did I mishear it? Maybe?
No, you just started mispronouncing it.
No, dude. You've heard of raffle stomping, right?
Of it.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
I don't use it as much because I don't shit in the shower.
I also don't shit in the shower. But no, like, just completely fucking up the most mechanical... you know, champion in the game with the most dog shit character in the game always brought me joy.
Yeah.
Like, tons of it. I don't know. I also, I like games, I like simulation games, but not so much like the Rim, shut the fuck up. Not so much the, like, the base simulation. Get it out, you fucking child. Do you have something to share with the class?
I'm surprised you don't like VR more.
No, dude, I just can't. I can't get into VR. I just don't. It's not my cup of tea. I don't necessarily like the base simulation games. I'm kind of more like, you know, things like Civ. Like, I love Civ. Back when I was staying with my grandmother over the wintertime, I played way too much Civ. I probably put, like, in a span of a week, I probably put, like, 40 hours into Civ at her place. Because I had on my Switch. So, I don't know. Just, that seems more fun to me than just having a base is, like, being a country or a civilization. Because, like, I also like, what's that other one we play? Stellaris. It's just, there's a lot more to Stellaris than I can keep track
of. It's a lot faster pace. Like, my biggest complaint about Civ is how slow it is.
See, I like going. I like it being slower because I can kind of see and manage what's going on a little bit better. With Stellaris, it moves so quickly that I feel like things get out of my control way too quick.
I like the concept of Civ, but then, like, I like the war simulation aspect, and I would much rather play Hearts of Iron at that point.
Yeah.
Like, because you can, like, move the units around on the map and whatever, and there's some strategy, but it's mostly about, like, playing optimal strategies with tech and buildings so that you can just pump out more units or, you know, whatever, and just crush people.
Yeah, it's like a
It's a turn-based Age of Empires.
Yeah, it's one that pauses for you every time.
Well, see,
because that's basically what Age of Empires comes down to, is you're just building up units and you're just throwing them at. There's very little micromanaging.
See, I never go for domination victories in Civ, because I just feel like it's so fucking boring. You're like, yeah, I could play this guy and just fucking eat everyone's ass by turn, like, 200. Oh, yeah, I could do that.
Oh, yeah, no, back when I played Civ, I would, rarely do that, because it gets boring, but, like, so does the rest of it after a while, then. It's just,
Clearly, you've never felt the amount of power of gaining 1,000 gold a turn from other civilizations and slowly bankrupting them until they crumble their own economic collapse.
It sounds like the bug in Stellaris, where, like, they introduced a new system, like a favor system, and essentially you could just drain. So alloys are what you use to make ships in Stellaris. Yeah. You would trade them favors for allies, but, like, a shit ton of favors doesn't do a whole lot for them, but they value favors incredibly highly, so you could trade them a favor for a monthly alloy gain, and you essentially just make the AI incapable of producing ships, and you have their entire alloy production.
That's like the AI bug when people were playing Monopoly. So you can get Monopoly on the Switch or whatever. What you can do is you can go around the board and buy every, like, you know, every property you, like, you can. You could immediately mortgage them to get your money back and then sell them to the other AIs. The AIs would spend money unmortgaging them.
I don't even know what you're talking about. I've never played Monopoly at this level, apparently.
Yeah. Speaking of Monopoly, did you know that the fastest game of Monopoly can be played in 21 seconds? Ah, yeah, that's kind of interesting, right? So here's how it works.
Just everyone else leaving you at the table because they don't want to play Monopoly? And you do.
No, because that's quicker than 21 seconds. No, so an actual game of Monopoly, I think it would requires two players. The first player has to have, it takes 9 roll to accomplish this, but you need to get to Boardwalk and Park Place, which are the two most expensive properties, right? Yeah. You get those. You put 3 houses on Boardwalk, the most expensive property. Then the other player has to roll and get a chance card and draw the specific chance card that is go to Boardwalk. This is immediately after setup. Well, 3 houses on Boardwalk, the rent is more than the starting money that you are given.
But how would you have bought both of those properties and put houses on them? No,
the rent, not purchasing. So to purchase both properties and the 3 houses, that takes all your setup money. That's it. So if you land anywhere else, you're fucked.
Yeah, but how does one player get to the end of the board, buy those stuff, put all the houses on before anyone else is?
It's some sort of mathematical chance. Like, you have to roll this at this specific moment. Like, because you can't roll and have...
Everyone else is rolling, like, threes.
Yeah. yeah, it's pretty nutty. NPR actually had an article on their website.
Oh, I guess if you roll double sixes, and then a five and a six, you can get pretty far on the board in a single turn.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, I don't know. Civilization, I don't know why I started to get away from it, but I just never... I played 4 a lot. I got into 5 for a little bit. Didn't really do it for me, and then I switched to Europa Universalis. It's another Paradox game.
Mm-hmm.
Again, where you play like a country in like 15th century Europe or whatever. That's the point. And that's not perfect either. Like, it has its issues, like Civ does. Again, pretty fun, like if I want to bankrupt people or just like, you know, do fun stuff, but...
Pandemic was a good game.
The board game or
the life simulator? No, but Pandemic, the one where you basically you made the virus or whatever, the fungus, the bacterium, whatever.
Plague Inc.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
I played a rip-off.
Pandemic is a board game.
Yeah, I played a rip-off version on my phone because I didn't feel like paying for Plague Inc.
Pretty sure it's free, or it was free.
Yeah, it's free for playing the virus.
Yeah, you can only play one of the... It's like the... You unlock the new pathogens with money.
Yeah. It's not like how it used to be where it was actually
I think you can buy the
game.
Full game on... Or you can play the full game on PC. Or you used to be able to when Flash games
were... You still have to buy it.
No, like, they used to be a Flash game.
Oh, yeah, it used to be a Flash
death
game.
Death
but...
Flash games is such
well, they're
trash.
Not dead. They're just not... They just don't function as well as they used to. You can still play some Flash games. That's really what we should have came on here and talked about, our favorite Flash games. Does everyone here remember Interactive Buddy?
No.
I probably saw
it. The gray, like gray figure that you just punch him?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a cathartic feeling. You could put George Bush's face on him. Or Bill Gates's. Yeah, that was fun. That was always a fun time. I like lighting him on fire and then spraying him down with the water hose.
How about RPGs? Do you guys play RPGs or JRPGs?
Oh, JRPGs, like Final Fantasy. Probably my favorite game ever is Final Fantasy X.
Really?
Have
you ever played Golden Sun?
No.
No.
I keep hearing about that.
It's an older JRPG, but it was by far, maybe after Pokemon, I guess, like one of my favorite JRPGs. Or it's just...
Does it have like a good story or is it like
it has
mechanics that are good?
It has an interesting story and it has like a really nice blend of all of the like classic JRPG mechanics. It's like the coolest thing is they had... I used to call them Djinn because I didn't know how to call it. It's genies,
same.
I guess. But they had these like little kind of guys that you would find that have different elements and you can use them in battle to do like very specific things. Sometimes they give you your like characters like resistance or they'd be like a special elemental attack or something. And then once you use a bunch of them, they're like set and ready to use for a summon. And then you have these really stronger summons that you would need different mixes of different elements of these guys set. And you could also set them before you go into battle. And then on top of that is you're just like classic JRPG elements where it's just like, you know, you have classes, you have items that change your classes, you have magic abilities, you have like direct attacks, and then you have your whole equipment management system. It really was like one of the more complete and like thought out JRPG systems that I've ever played, and it just
I am a sucker for turn based combat.
Yeah,
see, and that's I'm on the hunt for like a unicorn of RPGs because like what I want is like a side scroller esque RPG a la The Legend of Zelda or even The Binding of Isaac, but I want the more like new RPG elements to it, like a spell casting system or like, you know, skill trees and equipment, but while maintaining kind of like the pixel graphics.
I don't know what it is about like the old graphics. I just it really throws
it's
me
nostalgic.
Off. That's my problem with most JRPGs is like they just don't look nice.
Yeah, I mean, I have the perfect game for you and it's the grandfather of all JRPGs, Dragon Quest.
I keep hearing that it's good.
Yeah. So you could play Dragon Quest XI, which is, you can get it on Switch or you can get it on like pretty much any system now. And it has really fleshed out like regular graphics. But if you get, I think it's like the S edition or whatever edition, there's an alternate way to play where they have recreated the game in pixels, like your old style Dragon Quest games. And I mean, have you ever played a Dragon Quest game?
Probably not.
It was basically the first JRPG to come out.
Do you have to play that? Like, are they all interconnected, or are they like Final Fantasy, where like they're all completely different for the most
part? Yes and no. So they seem different at they seem like there's almost no connections at first, and then as you play them, there are some connections that make you think they're all one story. And then there's other connections that make you think they're just maybe three or four connected stories.
Okay.
But then there's also things that make you think, like, maybe they're not connected at all. Which is pretty interesting. Like, when you go through, like, if you're a really big fan and you do, like, a deep dive through all of them, it's, you know, I guess the nice part about it is really that you don't have to play the other ones to play any individual one necessarily. But it does add value if you play all of them.
Yeah, I've heard the Ni No Kuni games are good, too.
Haven't tried them out.
I haven't played any of them yet, but they're the same. I've heard they're in the same vein as Dragon's Quest. They're very similar to those.
The last, like, main RPG I played was Divinity.
Divinity's good. It's like digital D&D.
I haven't played it yet. I was between that and Pillars of Eternity. Okay. I played Pillars of Eternity 1, which I loved, but PoE 2 wasn't as great. So I'm probably going to start Divinity. I liked it. I heard that you could play, like, with other people.
Oh, yeah. We're doing. If you ever get it, we'll hit you up.
I keep fucking Aaron up.
So. It's Divinity Original Sin 2, because there's a lot that of, like, the Divinity games that have slightly different names that are completely
different genres. Yeah.
But,
Baldur's Gate's coming out soon, too, which is even more like Dungeons & Dragons.
I mean, that is D&D, right?
Pathfinder
King.
Yeah, it
is pretty much D&D, yeah.
And there's also Pathfinder
It's made by the
Kingmaker.
Same people.
Yeah.
It's the Pathfinder system that is just Pathfinder in a game. And if I don't know if you've ever played Pathfinder, but it's like the people who made 3.5 D&D snorted a bunch of crack and were like, let's fucking make a new game.
Yeah,
and
well,
it's got tons of extra shit.
Pathfinder was made because they didn't like where the Wizards was going after 3.5, and it's much closer to 3.5 because they liked that direction it was taking, and they took it that way.
3.5 and Pathfinder are for power gamers. Everything else is for casuals.
Fourth edition is not for casuals.
Fourth edition doesn't exist.
Fourth edition is the most combat fun version of D&D, but it's like a video game on paper. So it's
I've played fourth.
A lot of the abilities and class stuff are the power system was broken up into, like, you have a daily power, a once per encounter power, and then, like, an at will power.
Yeah,
was like the three ways they would do it.
Yeah, I've definitely
and
not played that.
The abilities are almost like video game abilities, but they almost all of them have to do with, like, positioning and stuff relative to your opponents. Not all of them, but a lot of them.
It feels like it would just slow combat.
So it makes it more like you're tracking a video game. So it's a little much for a role-playing game.
If you were dungeon crawling and your party just likes fighting, it was probably a great system. But just play 3.5. There's cooler shit you can do.
Yeah.
I don't know. Warlord was a class in 4th edition, and it was really cool.
So was Shaman.
4th edition had, like, some really great ideas that just, like, execution-wise...
sucked.
That weren't totally there. They could have probably used a little bit more time in the pot, but... the thing that makes me nervous about, like, 5th edition is that, like, I loved 3.5 just because, like, for the breadth of things you can do, there's just so many fucking books and so many different, like, builds and shit you can do. And now I'm hoping they don't just flip the table on us before they get to that point and be like, okay, here's 6th edition. Let's start all over again. Because it is more, like, it makes more money from an economic standpoint.
Yeah, I don't get why. I guess that's why they keep switching things up, but, like, why don't they just keep releasing new supplements for the same edition? I don't understand why they keep needing to, like, remake it.
I think because at a certain point, you don't need everything. From, like, if you look at their business model, it's like, if I'm playing D&D, I don't need every book at a certain point. At a certain point, I have so many books that, like, between that and the third-party marketplace, I could basically make whatever I want. So the idea is, like, let's just make a new edition, and now you have to buy all the books all over again, and we start all over again. And
that's what really got me out of Magic.
Too. Part of it is the
well, that and
like the
fire.
Core like engine of the edition of D&D, kind of like reaches a limit where you can only add so much complexity without like introducing new mechanics that aren't in the older stuff.
That's, yeah, hence the glyphs thing. Like glyphs, you are glyphy glyphs. Like,
okay, I was like, is this what? Because like I do this with words where I just like insert letters where I feel there should be letters. No, there and is I a thought
lot.
I was doing
there
it.
There is a lot. Glyphy glyphs, like 5th edition rules, basically make it an entirely new game. So to the point where glyph
it's like moon
moon like it makes it an entirely new game to the point where you almost don't need the core books, like honestly.
Yeah, you could play that as a standalone thing. It has all the rules you need to play the game.
Exactly.
Besides like the actual class information, but
well, I think we've started to get away from video games and we've started to move to tabletop RPGs. Maybe we'll have to have Lou back on to talk a little bit more about that, because you might know a thing or two about that.
If he wants to join us for this ordeal again.
I don't know. This has been a pretty harrowing experience after that first time. Hey, a lot of blood and guts in that that first podcast.
At least you should be thankful we let you out of the basement. Aaron stays here. Yeah.
So that's what that bit is for?
Yeah. But follow us on Twitter, Instagram, like our shit on Spotify, YouTube, subscribe to our channel, and
let us know what you think so far.
Yeah. Give us ideas for
episodes. Send us some emails. Yeah. What do you guys want to hear?
Yeah. Otherwise, you have to deal with whatever garbage comes out of my mouth during episode planning. So, yeah.
I don't know what half those things you were saying are.
Yeah, social media, Aaron.